Now in this video, I'm going to be demonstrating how I cut finger joints to make the boxes that I do. To cut my finger joints, I have dado blades mounted in my saw bench. And if you look at that dado blade, you can see that it's a series of blades, two outer cutting blades and two inner chipping blades. They are as dangerous as all get out. There are countries in the world where they are banned, because if you cut yourself with one of those, it's not like a circular saw cut. You take out a great lump of meat. You can't run safety guards on it, roving knives and other safety precautions. They are dead set dangerous. And in making this video, I don't wish to be encouraging people to go out and get dado blades, because the average table saw that you buy these days is not good enough, strong enough, stable enough to really be running dado blades on. It is something that I do, but I don't encourage others to do it. I don't want to be responsible for people losing fingers, hands, whatever. Now, first of all, I'll just demonstrate how, without running the machine and making a lot of noise, I'll demonstrate how this actually works. Over a number of years, I won't say perfected, but I've got a jig that I can adjust for making different size dados. And how it basically works is I've got a little step block put in there, which is the exact width of my cut. And I set it up so that I can make a pass through there, and it will cut out that slot. I can then move that slot over to that peg, and it's the right spacing to cut the next slot. And I go over and over till I complete the number of slots I want. Looks simple, doesn't it? But it's not as simple as what you might think. It has taken me a long time to get that sorted out so that it's reasonably well perfect. Now I'll demonstrate how it actually works, and I'll apologise beforehand for the noise, which hopefully we'll be able to edit out, but I need the dust extractor going as well as the saw bench. Hopefully those joints will fit together, as they do. They are as snug as can be. Now, I'll show you how I glue them together. Tight bond glue is my glue of preference. It's very good stuff. I use it to paint into the joints of this timber. Sometimes I make these joints a little bit tight. It depends a bit on the atmosphere and the moisture in the atmosphere as to how accurate that jig cuts. Sometimes it can be a bit tighter than others. And if it is a bit tighter than others, that's when my anvil and the rubber mallet come into play to drive it home snug. But generally speaking, this clamp arrangement will pull it in where I want it to go. Right. See how they go together. Oh, that's good. Okay, with a wet cloth I can just remove a bit of that surplus. This is where the mallet comes in. It up as tight as I can, squashing the glue out. Hopefully it'll be square. And if it's not quite square, I'll get that mallet to do a bit of persuading to get it to go where I want it to. Surplus glue removed. Square is always somewhere where you least expect it. Now, the outside of the box will have proud bits protruding to be sanded off, so I have to get the squareness from going on the inside. And in that case, it appears to be bloody near perfect. I'll give it a little bit of persuasion. And now it is perfect. Okay. Box is glued, it takes a while for it to dry, but as they say in the cooking programs, I've got one that we cooked up earlier, so if we go back to making the noise again and proceed over to this big sander, I'll show you how I take off the corners to make them flush and square, and how I make this faceplate square. bridge is getting very, very dull. Took a while to take that off, but I have the faces smoothed. I've taken off the proud bits on the corners. Now I'm going to check it against this template, which is exactly 200 wide by 280 long and is square. That tells me that I've got to take a bit more off to get it square. I won't bore you by doing it now, but when I do get it square, I will put it onto this sander, which is finer, just to get it down to a nice smooth finished surface. When I do this, when I make these boxes, I make them with rounded corners. You could well ask why, because it's not at all necessary. It's just one of those old things that have stuck with me because I've done it all my life. When I was a commercial apiarist, my hives were handled, stacks of super were handled on pallets with forklifts. And I found that whenever you're trying to guide a pallet of supers or hives onto a truckload, if they had round corners, you could wedge them in to a load, whereas if they were sharp square corners, they'd always catch. But I do that on my router. I do that rebate on my router to take splitting plates. I don't do splitting plates myself anymore. I've got other people that do them for me. That's actually for a smaller, thicker timbered hide, but I'll demonstrate that later. Once again, when I'm making my honey supers, they're 50 mil thick. I've had the top of it glued on and secretly screwed out of sight. I've rounded them on my router and sanded it ready for painting. Because I have spring clips with screw holes, I use a template to put those screw holes in the exact right place. And the reason why I do that before I paint is so that I can get primer sealer to go into those screw holes. My breather vents at the back of my brew chamber are 12 mil deep, and my entrances are also 12 mil deep. And I highlight and show off the timber joints by doing in that lacquer finish that you can see over there on the shelf. These hives on the top shelf are the hives that I regularly make and usually have available. That's a standard oak hive with a 50 mil super. Has a vent in the back, drain in the bottom, splitting plate, and a brood excluder that doubles as a viewing panel. This is the same hive except that top of the honey super is not permanently secured. It's a way of getting honey that's a little bit clearer, and you can put a bit of plastic on either side. Bees can get up into it, they'll fill it with honey, and you can hold it up to the light and you'll see where any pollen resin's been stored. Then you can take that out separately. It's just a better way of getting honey that doesn't have impurities. Inside of a typical hive, root excluder that has a plug that will fit into that hole to make it a viewing panel. And if you look down into it, you'll see the splitting plate. This one has a vent and a drain in the base of it, as well as one at the back. But that's pretty much my standard hive. A few years ago, Nick Powell and I both worked away at means of making, extracting honey differently. We came up with what Nick called series supers. I called them honey frames. By the way, there's an example of what I do when I make a flat lid. I paint it on both sides so it doesn't absorb moisture on one side only, and I brace it with that piece of timber and screw it into place. These are series supers. For those who are seriously into taking honey, I think it's a pretty good idea, but you need to have some, well, I made up a means, a spinner for spinning the honey out. A shallow super will allow the bees to build one deep honey pot. And I spike those honey pots without destroying them, or I put a nick across to open them up, and then I put them in a spin and I spun the honey out. That way I had a honey pot that I could put back into the hive that hadn't been destroyed and was ready for the bees to refill again. I don't make a lot of those, but I do make a few. This last hive is something I've only started making more recently. I was asked to make a batch of AA hives for Giorgio Venturieri, and I liked his idea and his style of making those hives, so I've been copying them a bit myself. Honey super on top. Small hole in the top for the bees to access the honey super. Two splitting plates in the middle of the brood chamber. Giorgio's idea is to have a ventilation in the bottom. And ventilation in the top. Seems to work quite well. I like it. And I've just started keeping AAs after 30 years of keeping native bees. For the first time, I now have a couple of AA hives, and I love them. They're a great bee, and I'm quite certain they're going to become more and more popular because they do handle heat and they handle cold quite well. And the honey tastes far better than other varieties. Well, you've seen how I made my finger jointed hives. I've been a bit reluctant to actually show people that because I don't want to encourage people to do it, because I know there will be a bit of grief and blood spilt if too many people have a crack at it. The next video will be our wrap-up video. I'll demonstrate how I make my spring clips. I'll demonstrate how I make metal roofs, and that'll be the wrap up.